Morning, church.
Morning.
I want to talk to y'all a little bit about wisdom today. The scripture says anyone that's lacking wisdom needs to ask the Lord for wisdom, and he'll give it to them. But you know, there's a whole book or two in here on wisdom. And the one I want to go to today is Proverbs. Now, I'm just going to be honest, you know. Every now and then, someone gives you a chance to be a little ornery and you get that way. And I had a grandmother call me about her grandson, and she was on the speakerphone. And she said, "Preacher, I want to ask you something about Scripture." I said, "Okay." She says, "Where in the Bible does it say, spare the rod and spoil the child?" I said, "Well, hang on a second." I said, "I can't tell you that. But I can tell you that in Proverbs 23, verse 13, it says, withhold not correction from the child, for if thou beatest him with the rod, he shall not die." And I heard this grandson in the background going, "No, no, no, no." One of these days I'll tell you who the grandson was. You know, every now and then the Lord gives you a chance to do something. And I kind of thought, you know, I was a little ornery with it. It was a little fun. But, you know, there's truth in that. When I go to marry a couple, first question I ask them is, are you both Christians? Are you both not? And they'll look at me kind of puzzled. And I said, the scripture says you're not to be unequally yoked. I said, I refuse to marry one Christian and one that's not. I said, if you're both not a Christian, I said, I don't have a problem marrying you. I'll do that under the state's law. If you're Christians, I'll do it under God's law. But I get to talk to them. Try to establish some wisdom with them. You tell them the things that they're going to argue about in a marriage. And they look at me and say, "Oh, preacher, how long have you been married?" I said, "About 30-some years. It's still going." "Okay, well, maybe ought to listen to you." And I give them the best advice I can. You know, things like when you're mad, it's, do you know what your son did? Do you know what your daughter did? You handle it. Because I'm so mad, I will go overboard and from punishment into abuse, and I don't want to do that. I always knew when I got home off of a 12-hour shift, and do you know what your boys did was the first thing I heard. The boys hated to hear Mom say that, knowing I was coming off of a midnight shift and I was tired and wanting to go to bed. Because that meant they were getting a whipping before they went to school. Yeah, think about that. But I didn't have to whip the boys often. Because early on I told them, this is a toy, this is a tool. You play with toys, you don't with tools. If you want to use a tool, you ask Mom and Dad. Someone said, "Well, that's awful simple." I said, "Well, yeah." I said, "If you break it down and make," I said, "you're dealing with a 1 and 2 year old. Make it simple." I said, "Keep it simple." Someone says, "Well, you got to have all your guns locked up and unloaded." I said, "I've got loaded guns laying everywhere." They're like, "How could you raise kids?" I said, "I told them it was a tool." I said, "And they won't touch a tool without my permission." They said, "Well," I said, "and when they were of about 8, when they were about 10, 8, and 6, I took them out and had a big old oak board there, and I made them smack their fists on it, and I made them smack their fists on their heads, and I went back and I fibbed a little bit. I said, this, now I had high-powered rifles that were stronger than my shotguns, but I said, this is a shotgun. It's not the strongest gun I had." I didn't tell them I was loading magnums at the time. I said, is that board harder than your head? They said, yes. I said, I pointed the shotgun at the board and I blew the board in half. I said, this is a tool. You don't play with it. And they never played with the guns. If you raise your children right, they're going to come out right. But we want to talk a little bit about wisdom. Because you can't raise kids without some wisdom from God. And I'm actually want to go over a chapter in Proverbs. And there's a reason for that. Because you can get into Proverbs and you get one verse and you just pluck it out. And it just seems so good. And it is. But sometimes we need to put a little context in it. Because, you know, you can go to 13:24 and say, he that spareth the rod hateth his son, but he that loveth him chasteneth him betimes. That means if your daddy don't love you, he don't whoop you. And if kids pay attention, the older they are, the less you have to whoop them. That's the way it is with our God, walk with God. He doesn't have to chasten us the more we grow up spiritually. In verse 17, he that covereth transgression seeketh love, but he that repeateth a matter separateth very friends. It means if you're going to do the same stupid thing over and over, you're going to make people mad and drive them away from you. Whoso rewardeth evil for good, evil shall not depart from his house. That means if someone does you a good turn and you turn around and do them bad, bad stuff's going to keep happening to you. It's pretty simple. And your parents tell you don't lie. Well, the Bible says not to lie. Well, here in Proverbs 19:9 it says, a false witness shall not be unpunished, and he that speaketh lies shall perish. It's pretty stout. That's got a little more bite to it than thou shalt not lie. And kids, why do you think your parents have been on you? Because in chapter 20, verse 11, it says, even a child is known by his doings, whether his work be pure or whether it be right. That means whatever people see you doing, that's what they know of you. That's what they expect of you. And you can't talk your way out of a situation you've acted yourself into. It just don't happen. We're going to go to chapter 22. And there's a lot of good scripture here. You've probably heard a few of these. But I want to go over chapter 22 because Proverbs is wisdom. And some days, I don't know about y'all, but I run a real shy on that wisdom. And I just need a little filling up. 22, verse 1. A good name is rather to be chosen than great riches, and loving favor rather than silver or gold. It's saying there's more important things than having money. A good name and loving favor. If someone's going to do you a favor just because they love you, if you've got a good name, if you're of good report, what's that mean? That means people say, well, there's a good person. I know because they do good things. They don't lie, they don't steal, they don't cheat. If you need something and they can get it for you, they do. If they don't, they know someone who does and they direct you that way. Good name. Verse 2, the rich and the poor meet together. The Lord is the maker of them all. That means it doesn't matter where you are, poor, rich, or in between, you're going to meet God just the same as everybody else. A prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the simple pass on and are punished. That kind of means that if you're smart and you see evil coming, you say, I'm going to prepare for that and I'm going to get out of the way. I don't have to. If you can look at something and say, you know, there's going to be a bomb go off there, you just kind of don't go there. And here it says, the simple people pass on and they're punished. How are they punished? They're there when the bomb goes off. I mean, it's kind of an oversimplification, but that's the way it works. Verse 4, by humility and the fear of the Lord are riches and honor and life. If you want riches and honor and life, you need to be humble and fear the Lord. And I look at TV and I see so many proud people. I watch, when I have to watch those judge shows, I not only see proud people, I see people proud in their ignorance. Thorns and snares are the way of the froward. He that doth keep his soul shall be far from them. The froward are the perverse. If you keep your soul away far from the perverse people, you won't go into the traps and the snares that they do. And they don't think that they're in traps and snares. But sin's like that. Scripture says that sin, that says there's pleasure in sin for a season. And then that little pleasure's not enough. You need a little more. So you go a little deeper in, and you add another chain, another manacle, another ball and chain. And pretty soon, whatever it is you're chasing, whether it's drugs, whether it's gambling, whether it's sex, whether it's NASCAR, whether it's soap operas, whatever it is, if you're chasing it, and it becomes more important to you to God than God, You're bound. You have tied yourself up to that. Have you ever noticed that if you try binding yourself to Jesus, he just keeps breaking them chains and say, you're free. You're free. I love you. Go on. Do what you want. According to my will, but you've got a lot of room in here. You can do a lot of things. Train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. That verse is giving more comfort to more parents. Having made their children go to church, having sat there and cracked their knuckles with a stick, wake up. You don't draw on that bulletin. You sit there and you listen to what that preacher's saying. He's breaking the bread of life. He's telling you something that's going to change your life. Pay attention. You do not play crossword on the back of the bulletin. And you know, if you think about it, the way you train a child, when they're old, that's the way they go. If you train up a child to be deceitful and lying and cheating, that's what they're going to do when they're an adult. It's rare that someone that gets out of what they're trained up into. So when these psychologists start asking, whoa, is it nature or nurture? Well, right here, Scripture says it's nurture. It says how you train them up is how they're going to end up. It's how they're nurtured. The rich ruleth over the poor, and the borrower is the servant to the lender. Yeah, the rich ruleth over the poor because they can buy more and they can do more. And the borrower is the servant to the lender. Yeah. We seem to forget that because to us, you know, we get some money from the bank to pay for something, then we pay the bank back. We forget that as a borrower, we are indebted to them, and that they could turn around and say, I don't want your money. I want you to do this for me. You do this for me and we'll call you the dead even. That's the way it used to be. It used to be a lot of times that in the old days, I could lend somebody some money if they were going to give me a percentage of their crops. Or if they were going to, tell you what, cow herder, I'll give you money to get you through this. But I want so many head of your cattle when it's time for you to drive them off so I can fill my freezers. People work that, people bargain that way. And the borrower was a servant to that lender. until such time as they're paid back. A lot of people don't like that language, but that's clear that that's what it is. 8, he that soweth iniquity shall reap vanity, and the rod of his anger shall fail. That tells you that if you're out there and you're seeing people who are doing evil things and they're succeeding, right there, it tells you they're going to fail. They're going to reap vanity, and their anger shall fail. It means their anger is going to come to naught. They might get mad, but you can laugh at them and go on. He that hath a bountiful eye shall be blessed, for he giveth of his bread to the poor. If you have a bountiful eye, that means the Lord's blessed you and you're looking to bless people. You know, look at what he's given us. It's a small gesture for Joyce to bring in hot cider. It's been greatly appreciated. But what if Joyce had said, oh, I'm just going to keep all this cider for ourselves. It wasn't enough this year. Joyce don't do that. Hey, Joyce spreads it around. Sure, if her garden's overflowing, good chance you're going to get some. It's just the way, that's a bountiful eye. Cast out the scorner, and contention shall go out. Yea, strife and reproach shall cease. If you got someone that's scorning, get them out. And a lot of your troubles will be gone. A scorner. What's a scorner? Scorner is someone who doesn't believe. They're going to mock. They're going to try. You can sit there and you can make case after case based on logic and on faith. And they don't care. They're going to mock you. They're going to scoff. And here it says, just get rid of them. And all your contention will go out. And your strife and your reproach shall cease. It'll get peaceful. It says in the last day there'll be mockers. Here it says we don't have to put up with them. We can toss them out. He that loveth pureness of heart, for the grace of his lips, the king shall be his friend. He that loveth pureness of heart, for the grace of his lips, the king shall be his friend. It means your rulers are going to be your friend if what's coming from your lips shows that you love a pure heart. That means living right. And by living right, I mean according to what God says right here, the Bible. Doesn't mean living like Jack LaLanne and exercising every morning and living like one of those vegetarian gurus, eating the veggie shakes and being healthy. No, hey, vegetarian is an old Indian word for bad hunter. Hey, the Lord put us at the top of the food chain. You doubt him? Wait till we get the kids back in here and I go to answer their question. The eyes of the Lord preserve knowledge, and he overthroweth the words of the transgressor. You ever notice that if you get into a discussion with a sinner, especially someone who is really anti-Christian, that you start making the cases, you start putting things out, they're going off and they're bringing in all these wild things because you're going after what they're saying. They're trying to distract you so that they can say you didn't know what you were talking about. It's like, what are you talking about? You said this. We're going after this. They don't like it because they know they can't stand up to the truth. There's why. Because the Lord's preserving your knowledge and overthrowing their words. The slothful man says, there's a lion without. I shall be slain in the streets. Lazy man says, oh, the terrible army that's coming. They're going to take us over. That's a slothful man. I think your average West Virginian would lock and load and say, let's get it on. Your average West Virginian ain't slothful. I grant you there's some. But if you look, why are people not slothful? Because they believe in what the Bible says. And the Bible quite clearly says, if you don't work, you don't eat. Well, eating's a pretty good, that's a pretty good thing to want to do, so you're going to work. And if you're working, you aren't slothful. So when the lion comes roaring around, oh, old Satan, we're ready to face him. The mouth of a strange woman is a deep pit. He is abhorred of the Lord that shall fall therein. Now, on a very baby Christian level, that's talking about prostitution. Okay? You stay away from those kind of women. On a more adult Christian level, that's talking about going after another religion, going after another God. It's talking about leaving Christ and, ooh, it's easier over here. I don't have to believe all this. I can just do this and I'm going to heaven. I don't have to worry. I don't have to go to church. So-and-so in my family is a Mormon and they were baptized for all the dead people in the family and for me too, so we're going to heaven. That's a Mormon doctrine, okay? I don't agree with it. It's non-scriptural. What was it, my grandma's? Oh, bless their little hearts. But there's people that want to believe false things. They go, it's saying don't go after them, or you'll be a, don't leave your love of Jesus, or you'll be abhorred of the Lord. Abhorred means abhorred is when you got, you think you've got spaghetti and meatballs, and you go to take a bite, and your tongue and your suddenly tells you this ain't spaghetti and meatballs. That's abhorred. You go, I don't know what it is. There's people here. Let me get up. That's what abhorred is. Verse 15, foolishness is bound in the heart of a child, but the rod of correction shall drive it far from him. A little more ammo, Mom and Dad. A little more ammo. He that oppresseth the poor to increase his riches, and he that giveth to the rich shall surely come to want. That's pretty clear. If someone's really struggling to make it, and you know they're trying, as a Christian, you're more likely to say, well, here, have this, or I can't give it to you, but I can cut the price for you. Whereas a non-Christian would look at them and say, full price, or they might say, hey, let me jack the price up here. He won't know nothing. It's clear here. God says, don't do it. Bow down thine ear and hear to the words of the wise, and apply thine heart unto my knowledge. For it is a pleasant thing if thou keep them within thee. They shall be withal be fitted in thy lips. It's a pleasant thing to hear the words of the wise and apply it in your heart unto God's knowledge. And then it will come out of your lips. That's pretty easy. That thy trust may be in the Lord, I have made known to thee this day, even to thee, I have not written to thee excellent things and counsels and knowledge, that I might make thee know the certainty of the words of truth, that thou might answerest unto the words of truth to them that send unto thee. He's saying, have I not written you this stuff? Have I not written you good counsel that you can talk to people and tell them about? Rob not the poor because he is poor, neither oppress the afflicted in the gate. The gate's where all the people that had problems went, because that's where the elders met during the day to judge the nation of Israel and solve their problems. For the Lord will plead their cause and will spoil the soul of those who spoil them. So ultimately, God's going to take on their case. That right there ought to be a warning to all judges. A judge gets his authority from God, not from man. And as a judge, he better be judging the way God would want him to judge. He's got a whole book to tell him how to judge. You're not to oppress the poor. You have certain authority, certain things you do not. You know, if two people came to me with a dispute about Scripture, I would have some authority to say something about it. If they would come to me with a dispute about, well, so-and-so's doing this, and so-and-so's doing that, and here's what Scripture says, and they would accept my authority as pastor, I could solve that for them. There are things that I have authority in because God's granted it to me. But you know, if a couple came to me and they said, well, Dad died and I want this part of the farm, but they want that part of the farm, and we're having this problem, you know what I'm going to tell them? I got no authority here. I can't settle this for you. Go to the courts. Go where the authority is that can deal with this. You know what Jesus did? He had someone that wanted them to settle stuff that where their father died, and Jesus like, no, that's not for me to do. Make no friendship with an angry man, and let a furious man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go. If someone is steaming, and they say, come on, follow me. Isn't it kind of like watching a guy with a grin on his face go, hey, y'all, watch this. You're going to get the same effect. Make no friendship with an angry man. Well, how can you be friends with someone who's angry? Yeah, I can get mad, especially at stupidity I see coming out of Washington, D.C. But angry? No, there's no sense in being angry over it. What control do I have over it? Am I going to give them more control over my life than Jesus has? Not a chance. Lest thou learn his ways and get a snare set to that. That goes back to 24. Make no friendship with an angry man, and with a furious man thou shalt not go, lest thou learn his ways and get a snare to thy soul. That means if you follow a furious or an angry person, you're going to pick up their attitudes and they're going to lead you off of the straight and narrow and you're going to get caught. Verse 26, be not thou one of them that strike hands or of them that are sureties of debts. If thou hast nothing to pay, why should he take away thy bed from under thee? Okay, that's talking about not being someone that strikes hands. Don't be fighting. Or them that are sureties for debts. Back in the old day, if I had to borrow money off of Farmer John and I couldn't pay it back to him, Frank, Ray, James, you're going to go work that man's land for the next 3 years. He ain't going to pay you a dime. He'll feed you and give you a place to sleep. But you're going to do that till I'm out of debt. My sons were being my surety of that debt. Now, you don't do that. It's saying don't do that. In the second verse says, if you have nothing to pay, why should you take away the bed from under your feet? So if you got to, you got to, but there's a certain point you don't go to. If you're down to where you've got your house and your bed, and you're looking to put that up against something, you're doing something wrong. You need some help more than what you're getting, because you're beating your head on the wall. 28, remove not the ancient landmark which thy fathers have set. Believe it or not, that's talking about property rights. The ancient landmarks, those are the originals, what they call the original calls in the deed. In the Old Testament, they'd make an agreement, and they'd stack up a pile of rocks, and they'd give it a name. And they'd lay hands on it, and this rock pile is a witness to our agreement. That and everybody that's right. We're going to call this one Ebenezer. We'll call this one Ed. If you think I'm making it up, look it up. It's the way they did it. And those landmarks were there so that their children and their grandchildren and their generations that followed would know that landmark and know who was where. That was the whole purpose of that landmark. Here it's saying, do not remove the ancient landmark. What happens when people move landmarks? You've seen that. You get hate, you get discontention, you get people fighting and fussing, and it don't go away in generations. Over just a few inches. 29. Seest thou a man diligent in his business? He shall stand before kings, he shall not stand before mean men. A man who is diligent in his business, who does the best job he can do, he's going to stand before bosses. He's not going to stand before people going to torment him. That's what it's talking about. Wisdom. I know a lot of people will look at Proverbs and they'll say, it's so fragmented. You get the verse on this and a verse on that, just packed back to back. Stop and look at, see if you can, you've got a theme going there. Most assuredly, you'll find that there is a theme. And it's wisdom. It's good. There's a lot of things in Proverbs. You start reading them, you say, well, I can remember my grandma saying that to me. I just thought that was an old wives' tale. How many things that are in the Bible do you think old Ben Franklin wrote down in Poor Richard's Almanac? Or Martin Luther King Jr. put in his speeches? It's all I got, church. Any of y'all watch that, I know I asked this last Sunday, any of y'all get a chance to watch that American Bible Quiz? I recorded the last one, I don't have that, but the one before that had a section called Genesis or Genesis. Is it in the book of Genesis or was it written by the band Genesis? I sat back and I looked, Kitty was there and James was there, I'm like, I got this one. There's one. Whiff! I missed that one. Crack! I got that one. I tell you what, first two of them shows I seen, I thought, yeah, I'm doing pretty good. I've only missed one on the first one. I missed one on the second. Well, that third one humbled me. I, I whiffed three times. On the easy ones. It's a fun show. I really enjoy it. And they're playing for charity, so that's a wonderful thing. In case the kids don't get out here, I'm going to give you your answer to your question. Why? And the question is, why do we have poisonous snakes and animals that can hurt us? Okay, that's a good question. And I'm going to tell you where. I'm going to tell you, yes, the answer is in Genesis. The book, not the band. Love getting questions from the kids. Hey, they've given me some sermon topics before. Their kids are great. But this is neat. It's going to sounds like a difficult question. There's an easy answer, but it's actually spread all out across the third chapter of Genesis through Noah landing on Mount Ararat. Okay, I mean the answer spread that far in time. Oh mercy! Praise the Lord. It's been a good place to be. Remember, if you beat him with a rod, it won't kill him. And I did. I swear, I heard no, 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 no.
What did you say?
It was good. All right. We have a question, and it's a real good question. The question is, why do we have poisonous snakes and other animals that can hurt us, like lions and tigers and bears? Oh my! Well, let's take the Wayback Machine. And we'll slap it on the Bible and we'll dial it back to Genesis, okay? And we go back to the Garden of Eden. And in the third chapter of Genesis, we find that when Adam and Eve sinned, there's certain things that happened. Before Adam and Eve sinned, there weren't thistles. There weren't thorns, and probably not poison ivy, and all those nasty plants. Well, that's part of the curse God put on them. And God put enmity, which means hatred, between men and serpents. Which means we don't like snakes, just because God said we don't like snakes. Now I'm going to ask you kids a question, and I'm going to give you the answer too. What did animals eat back in Adam and Eve's day? Didn't matter what kind of teeth they had, the Bible's clear, they all ate plants. So all animals ate plants and got along with men because Adam named them all, except for the snakes. We had a problem with snakes. Until they get off of the ark. Now, you think about it, the land's drying out, and you've got all these animals all clustered together with just a few people all clustered together. God needs them to disperse. How's he going to get them to disperse? Well, it says God put fear of man in animals. Because he told man, you can eat animals now. Here's a list of what you can and what you can't. So they scattered. The animals scattered. And as they scattered, they're no longer friendly to men. So your lions and tigers and bears that used to eat hay and grass suddenly discovered they had sharp teeth and they could eat meat. And your snakes, which had these fangs that they never used because they were going along eating little leavings of grass and stuff, crawling on their bellies like you're supposed to, suddenly they found out that they could hurt men. So the reason that these things are here is because way back when man sinned, and while animals are a blessing to us, we have to grow up to know how to handle animals or they can hurt us. And that's a lesson of how we have to live our lives. We have to grow up so we know how to handle life. And as a Christian, you get saved and you're considered a baby. And as you grow up, you learn to handle spiritual things. So actually, if you get to it, it's a picture of what happened with the animals in relation to man is a picture of us having to grow up. And that's where that is. Did that answer the question for y'all? Okay, good. Anybody else got anything? Going once, going twice. Okay, let me get out of this pulpit. We're getting down to opinion now, okay? It ain't in the Bible, but dumb old Bill give you his opinion. That's a big old ark Noah had. That was a massive ark. What did he have to bring? How many